guys and girls presenting this year. And there's a lot of French people in the room, so I hope next year we'll get more proposals from France. We are craving for it. I don't know about the rest of the audience, but I'd like to see more French presentations. So thank you for proposing this, and you have the floor.
Hello, everybody. We present today an investigation we did in April 2006. Yeah, Nobody. We work on with Paul and Alexandra on this case. Oh fuck! it's normal. It's Linux. And we found interesting things between during this forensics investigation. So we present today our results. And if you have intelligence about this case, we're very, very interesting to share and exchange on this case. So during this investigation, with Alex, I work with Alexandra and Paul, and now Paul changed of company. That's why he mentioned future ex Sequoia. And Alexandra, you present.
Okay. I'm Alexandra Toussaint. I work at the SOC CERT Open Minded. And last year, during the investigation, I worked for Sequoia.
In CERT. So, and like Islander, I'm still Sequoia at the head of CERT. And in Sequoia, I'm chairman in threat intelligence. So, the context. GMC Consulting is a cyber insurance expert. And he called us and say, we have a problem. We have a client with a fraudulent bank transfer. And my customer say it's not my fault. I'm not guilty of this transfer. And the bank says yes, it's your customer is guilty, and it's your account office leaders was accused by the bank to make fraudulent transfers. And why? Because to make transfers on the website of the bank, the customers used 2FA authentication on the bank. So the customer has a token to connect at the bank and a password, normally for 2FA authentication. So the bank say it's not possible to have another transfer by another person is surely it's your customers, and the person say and promise no, it's not me, and there was a trial between the customers and the bank. Why? Because in France, with the SEPA transfer and the SEPA transfer, the bank is responsible of the transfer between France and other country. And the bank say, yes, it's a good transfer, or it's not, it's a fraudulent transfer. And the bank authorized the different fraudulent transfer. And the price of the fraudulent transfer is a bit elevated because the customers lost 800,000 euros between different transfers, and the bank didn't reimburse the recredit, didn't recredit the account of the customer. So I take my my magic mantle and start the investigation with Alexandra and Paul. So we receive a disk.
So for this investigation, we followed a basic methodology. First, we made a disk image and created a timeline to understand what happened. For the timeline, we used Plasso and we look at the file system activity, and we used Pereg for the registry. Given that Drydex was very active when the computer was compromised and that we were confronted to bank fraud, we were looking for a banking Trojan. So yes, we are analysts, so money, Drydex, banking Trojan. No.
Ah, sorry.
No. Spoil. So what have we found? First, in the MFT, we found a file created on the 8th of June named AGYDSF.VBS. Sing with me and Drydex. Does it look like it? Don't think so. And we found out that the next day, a file named C, lot of C, just kidding, that XD.VBS was created in the temp folder. Fortunately, those two VBS files were still present on the disk, so we get them, and then we deobfuscated them.
We are French, sorry.
Yeah, so sorry. Yeah. two letters to... So we found out that they were downloaded an exe from the two IPs.
Here two. And here.
if you want, 2.12.76.130.99. And so those IP were located in Moscow. So two VBS obfuscated, downloaded exe. Okay, the MFT. No.
Okay.
Not no. we found two files in the MFT, and then we looked at the registry, and we found a run key named www.notify that was running 4cc1.temp, and this is a way for Drydex to persist.
Da, da, da.
So at this stage, we could have stopped the investigation because we demonstrated that Drydex was installed on the computer before the transfers were made. Sorry, but we are curious, so we decided to look at the MFT a few days later, and then we found out that a file named j.bat was created 6 days later.
So, after Drydex was installed on the computer, we found this file. Nobody can see that it's a 65 base 64 encoding. No? Yeah. Pretty easy to see. And the payload is a zip stream. This file fork PowerShell and map a shellcode in memory directly. It don't download an executable or like that. It just map a shellcode directly on memory. And normally, this part is a Paul part, but it's sick, so I take your his job. So ZGBAT drop a PowerShell and direct call the system runtime of .NET virtual machine. And you don't see on the bottom, but you used a virtual alloc API, read memory, write in memory to put the shellcode directly in memories. And in memories, the shellcode map load library. Everybody knows load library. It's an API to link directly a DLL. All processes on Windows use this this function. And imap WS2_32.dll. It's Microsoft WinSocket. Is to play with the network of API Microsoft. And it creates a socket between the infected computers and the this API, this IP. And it receives a second shellcode, but we didn't catch the second shellcode because the IP is taken down when we want to download directly the shellcode, because the time between the compromission and the analyze is 6 months between the two acts. So he make a virtual alloc to allocate in memory, and directly he map the second shellcode in memories. And but we don't have the second shellcode. But we are smart. We read the timeline, and the timeline just after GBAT creation, we found remote utilities. Remote utilities is a magnificent remote administration tools. McAfee Secure, yeah. So we conclude the second shellcode installed the ERAT directly on the computer, and the attacker had a total control of the computer. And all setting of RAT is directly recorded in registry, so it's very easy to have this IOC. So why we think which link between DryDex, JBAT, and the RAT? Between JBAT, GPointByte, and the RAT is very, very easy, because it is a timeline directly. We have 40 million seconds between the creation of JBAT and the installation of the RAT. So the people is very, very quick, very, very fast, but I don't know. For me, it's a GBAT install with a second shellcode directly the RAT on the computer. Is the first conclusion. The second conclusion between DryDex and GBAT, we don't have any evidence to download by the user of GBAT. So it's a program to download and install GBAT on the computer, and to conclude, we have five days between GBAT, the creation of GBAT, and the compromise of DryDex. So for me, it's a Drydex. Download GBAT, execute GBAT, and install the RAT. Where the RAT is used by the two fraudulent batch transfers performed. The attackers stay behind the computers, and the customers put the token directly on the computers, and to connect directly on the website. And the attackers record directly the login mode pass, and in password. Wow. I'm French. Password. And he makes the fraudulent bank transfers with directly the RAT when the token is connected at the computers. Why we don't have evidence in the browser history? Because I think the attacker used a privacy session of the web browser. So we know no trace, no evidence of the connection by the RAT directly where he used the browser. And why we think is not the same group between Drydex and the threat actors make fraudulent transfers is not the same TTP in threat intelligence. Drydex is very very low tech to install, and he used tricks to install and persist on the computers, but it's low tech. The PowerShell is the most complicated, and the attacker used directly the function and the API directly on the PowerShell. This kind of techniques. So for us, it's not the same groups, and we think Drydex resolved the different C2 at another threat actors when the victims is victims like firm of investment firm or lawyers or because these people have money, and your own management money with the bank, and directly with the bank. They now have a service to make that. So if you not yet. If you have a question about this case, and for your information, the GPON byte is until now 0 VT. We don't have any match on VT, and so if you have seen the same TTP on case, we are very very interesting to share and to discuss about kind of techniques, because we think they are threat actors, not Drydex, but threat actors, another group, and it's very very interesting to know who and where. Normally, it's threat intel.
So the problem is all the jokes are in French, actually.
Yeah. So in the first slide, we are a French joke. Sorry.
So who has a question? Come on.
I hope it's okay so if I ask the question in English. I think, just to make sure I understood it correctly, I think Alexandra said at some point it would have sufficed for the investigation if you had found Drydex on the machine. Is that correct? So, but doesn't that kind of mean that if you are infected with Drydex that you can do all sorts of crazy things and then go to your bank and say, Drydex? It wasn't me being drunk, it was Drydex.
The problem is when we made the investigation, Drydex didn't make a fraud transfer like that with 2FA. So that's why we continue directly on.
I understand why you continued the investigation. I just wondered if as a bank. It would suffice to say, oh, there's malware. I mean,
the response of the bank.
Yeah,
yeah. We don't exchange with the bank, okay. And the society of GMC consultant didn't make analyse on the computer. So we made the analyst and. We give the results directly at GMC, and GMC in trial make a procedure to the trial. So the bank didn't see the Drydex on the computer.
The infection was made the same week than the transfers, and so. We can say that this is the Drydex fault and not the employee. And on the other end, the bank let a transfer of 800,000 euros without asking any question, and we found malware at the banking trojan, and so there were proofs. More than this is the employee and
fair enough. And good talk, by the way.
Okay, one last question.
So thank you for the good talk and the well representation of the French population. I think it's great, being French myself. You did a whole space forensics, but when I see what you've done, I mean, you have the IP address of the payload, you have for your timestamps, and I'm sure there are guys in the room who could help identify the botnet ID, the affiliate number, and other information regarding the Drydex part of it, and then maybe. It could be useful to somebody.
The IP. Yeah, we when we made the investigation with for Drydex, on this case, there are a paper on internet about specifically. VBS, and we asked the question at different certs and different everybody say yes, it's okay, it's a botnet 121. I don't remember the ID correctly, but yeah, it's really it's known. This case is known, but the problem is here. Is unknown, we don't any search. Just I think said me no that this we haven't seen that ever before. In virus total, this IP we have zero hits. So
targeted?
I don't know it's targeted. I think it's it depends on victims. And if a victim is a lawyer or an investment manager, the actor change and he use the C2 just for the operation, and he take down the C2 after fraudulent bank transfers. So for forensics and investigation is very, very complex.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.